Hey girl, let's talk crime. So in this video, we are going to discuss day 2 and 3 of the R. Kelly trial. Geronda Pace, also known as Jane Doe number 4, is still on the stand on day 2, and she is giving more testimony about her relationship with R. Kelly. Geronda talked about being emotionally, physically, mentally, sexually abused by R. Kelly. She was often made to dress up as a Girl Scout, putting her hair into pigtails while having sex with him. That was recorded. These recordings were often pointed out by R. Kelly and showed her where she could improve in different sexual positions. So the defense accused Geronda of breaking into R. Kelly's home and waiting for hours for an autograph, also skipping school to support him at his child pornography case, and lying to her mother about where she was at. They even went as far as asking her, is she a groupie? And that's when Geronda did break down, and she asked the judge for a moment to get herself together before reading an entry from her diary. So Geronda reads an entry from her diary on the day that she left Robert, and it says, I went to Rob's house and Rob called me a silly bitch. He slapped me 3 times and said, if I lie to him again, it's not going to be an open hand next time. He spit in my face and my mouth. He choked me during an argument. I had sex with him. I had oral sex with him. And then I became fed up with him and came home and confessed. And when she was talking about confessing, she was referring to telling her mother everything that had been going on as it related to R. Kelly. Geronda had talked about a book that she had wrote about their relationship, which earned her at least $25,000. And she had also received multiple financial settlements from R. Kelly. Geronda's testimony was concluded on day 2, as she is 9 months pregnant and the judge wanted to ensure that she would not go into labor on the stand. Also on day 2, Chris McGrath, which is a Chicago-based physician who has been R. Kelly's physician for 25 years, had testified under a subpoena. Chris McGrath said that he had suspected that R. Kelly had genital herpes as early as June 2000 because a lot of the symptoms that he was exhibiting. However, when given a test, he did test negative, but he did say that the timing of the test was extremely important and that false negatives are pretty common. He went on to tell R. Kelly that it was important for him to inform his sexual partners that he did have herpes so that they had the option of having sex with him or not. And it wasn't until March 2007, according to medical records that prosecutors presented, that he did begin prescribing the herpes treatment drug Valtrex. So this information coming from this doctor is really a blow to the defense because it is proving that he knew that he had an incurable disease at least since 2007. Chris also went on to say that R. Kelly never paid for his medical services at all. He would fly he and his wife out to concerts, to parties, and all over the country. 2019, shortly before his arrest, was the last time that he had spoken to R. Kelly. Day 3 of the trial started out talking about Aaliyah. Now, I know a lot of people are kind of like, you know, she passed away. Let's let her rest in peace. And that is absolutely true. So I definitely mean no disrespect, but this is part of the trial. She is actually Jane Doe number 1. And what people are saying with Aaliyah is that he had sexual misconduct with a minor knowingly, and he allegedly got her pregnant and then bribed a government official to create a fake ID in order to marry her to protect himself from her testifying against him, because a wife or husband, vice versa, does not have to testify against the other. So prosecutors called Carolyn Harris, who has been a Cook County court clerk for 21 years, who issues birth, marriage, death records. And she testified that anyone that was seeking to marry at that time had to present a valid ID and be at least 18 years old. And if they were younger than 18, then they had to be accompanied by their parent. She then went on to say on cross-examination that she was not the clerk who handled the Kelly Aaliyah marriage documents in 1994. The marriage was later annulled. Demetrius Smith, who was his assistant and tour manager between 1984 and 1996, was also on the stand. He was under subpoena and also receiving immunity from prosecution for his testimony. So according to Demetrius, he thought it was a bad idea because Aaliyah was underage, but he wanted to quote unquote stay in the loop. So he did end up bribing a welfare office worker with $500 in cash to assist him in getting Aaliyah a fake ID. However, according to Demetrius, it was Daryl McDavid, which is Kelly's accountant slash manager, who was able to arrange the illegal marriage to Aaliyah, and he is not sure exactly how he pulled it off. Another person who took the stand, Anthony Navarro, who was a former assistant starting in 2007, said it was almost like the Twilight Zone. You went into the gate and it was just a different world. It was a strange place. Anthony went on to say that the girls would have to ask for permission to do simple things like getting a ride or going to get something to eat. He was not allowed to talk to any of the girls when he would take them places. And he did confirm that he does remember seeing Geronda Pace in the studio and had often brought her food and remember her asking permission to be able to eat. Anthony, who went on to work with other high-profile celebrities such as Taylor Swift, Kanye West, and Jay-Z, just said that the task and the things that he had to do while working with R. Kelly and the things that he saw were just a little bit bizarre. Testimony will continue on Monday.